and this is what winter looks like in Georgia. I found this dead on the side of the road, figured I'd turn it into a hat. It keeps me warm, so. It's funny because the weather report said that we were gonna have a wintry mix and snow on the ground, so. For all you folks up north, this is pretty comical. And because it is just windy and misty, rainy, and just blah out here, not a whole lot that we can do. But I do have something that we can go over, and we're gonna hop into the garage where it's just like a degree or two warmer to talk about that. So I got a letter through the snail mail saying that my soil tests were done and I had to just call them up with a credit card to pay for them. Did that, they emailed it over and I printed it out. And I have no idea what I'm looking at. I see a helpful chart and some numbers. So I'm gonna call up somebody who knows how to read this and can decipher what's going on here so that we can all learn how to read a soil test. Call the dirt preacher up himself.
You're on with John.
On with John. John Perry.
That's me.
Dirt preacher.
Who is this?
Paul freaking Castleberry.
Oh, I know you.
I think you do.
How's life?
It is wonderful. I'm dealing with a lovely Georgia winter today. So, you know, half the state's shut down because of the threat of maybe a half inch of dust.
Ah, snowmageddon.
Yes. So, how's life for you out in the old west?
It's beautiful. I am making phone calls and changing the world.
One particle of soil at a time.
That's exactly right.
So, you have a soil test of mine.
Yes.
And I need it broken down to an elementary level, because I'm looking at this and it kind of looks like your helpful chart that I've seen you present in some of your presentations.
Yes, it is a helpful chart. Okay, let's run through this thing real quick. So I am looking at page one at the moment. It is what I would expect to see for Georgia soil.
When you say page one, are you looking, is that sample front 01?
Front 01, yes.
Okay, so this is gonna be the Bermuda grass.
That is correct.
Okay.
Okay, so here's what we got. We're just gonna go straight down the line here because soil pH is going to be your first limiting factor that needs to be dealt with. This will be requiring lime. A suggestion would be calcitic lime. Somewhere between 10 and 15 pounds per thousand is what this is gonna take to get it buffered up. And honestly, you could go higher. This is one that could be dripped up into 20 pounds per thousand to get it up into a higher pH range, but anywhere around 15 would be good.
Okay.
So organic matter, low. That's gonna take something that takes a little time to get corrected. I am, you know, we can see some changes in that probably towards like the 1.8 to 1.9%, maybe even up to 2 in a single season if we start cycling these other things. Your CEC reading is interesting. I found that to be a little bizarre.
So CEC, what is that?
Cationic exchange capacity.
Okay.
Basically the electrical conductivity of your soil. Also measuring particle size, and this, depending on how everything mixed together and what the base was that the sod was grown on or whatever, there does seem to be some sand in this mix because it says it's a 2.8 CEC, which is very low. Typically that would indicate a larger particle size, and I know that looking at the soil, it didn't seem like there was a whole lot of sand in there. It was more red clay, so that's kind of interesting.
Yeah, that is. So what would it normally be? What should it be at?
There isn't necessarily a should on that. This is just what's making up the compounds of the soil. This is sort of the aggregate, and it's particle size. So you just have a larger, more particulated soil.
Gotcha.
Less plates, less contact with things. Let's keep scrolling down through here. Saturation levels are okay. I don't really see a whole lot of issue there.
And what are those indications of? What are those again?
So this is basically what's going to be carrying your nutrients in through the soil, in through the water, in through the roots. 75% on calcium, almost 18% on mag, 5% on potassium. Potassium's good. I like that. 2 to 5 is okay. It could be some adjustments here. It's a little tricky. You know, your magnesium is high. So what's going to happen is this: using calcitic lime, that is not going to be providing much of a magnesium source. So your saturations are going to change. When we add the lime in, the base saturation for cal will either increase or stay stable, but you'll see the other ones come down to make the proper space to carry nutrients in to get a good balance in there.
Okay.
Otherwise, I'm going to drop down into the chart on the bottom, which is how I would say most people need to look at where their limiting factors start.
Okay.
Obviously, phosphorus is low.
Way low. Yeah.
It is way low. That can be done with a corrective dose pretty simply. If you were going to put out some sort of a combo with some phos in it, you could do that. Bringing it up into a midline level, you are currently showing 16 parts per million. That really needs to be in like the 40 to 80 part per million range would be ideal. Getting it kind of up into that range gets you in pretty good shape. You'll be on the low end of at 40, you'll be getting into a good balance at 80, and that's not so bad. K is okay. That is something that can just be easily built into as the season goes on.
Right.
Also, magnesium's okay. Boron is low. That's something that you can pick up out of using 002. It only takes, an ounce or two, or that's maybe 16 ounces an acre of boron would change that huge. So it's not going to take much to get that changed around. So Not a whole lot of like issues here, but if we were trying to get more of a dense turf, we'd want to do a corrective application of something with phosphorus in it, and make sure we're getting minor elements out there. The other copper, manganese, zinc, iron are all in good levels. There's not really a whole lot else that would need to be done there.
So
I
look at the iron and it's like, it's like the highest one on there. What is that something to be concerned with? Or when a typical homeowner would see that, like me, I see that and I kind of go like, what the crap's going on there?
Right. What we look at with that one is how can we use the iron? Because ferric iron is what you're getting here, and that's what contributes to the red color of your soil. So getting that to break down using something like the aerate would contribute to getting that pulled down and chelating some of the iron back up so the plant can actually use it. That's what we'd be looking at doing, is using some of those other complexing those metals with like humic and weak acids.
Gotcha. Okay.
So that would be what I'm looking at there. Now, it's mild stuff. This isn't going to take a whole lot of change. Now, going into the backyard, I could make some speculations on this.
Okay.
pH is slightly higher, not enough to really, be a shocker. You're going to run, in order to actually get a good balance here with your saturations, this would require calcitic lime. Again, you'd be putting that out. Dolmitic on the back, because you have a lower saturation of magnesium. So dolmitic lime would be going in the back. But looking at like your phosphorus level in the back, the reason I would speculate that's higher is because of the trees.
Okay, interesting.
Backyards are going to have less disruption than front yards when they're put in, when they're doing streets and digging foundations and moving things around. And with leaf tissue, breakdown of organic matter, in a sense, a level of eutrophication, the breakdown and releasing of phosphorus is going to come from natural sources. That's likely what's happening in the backyard there.
Okay.
And, Obviously, nothing is going to need to be put down there as far as phos goes. pH, still, it is a little bit of a bump, you know, about 15 pounds, 1,000 is what you're going to need. You're still, your boron is interesting how it's low on both sides. That's probably a little bit because the iron is blocking. So we could see as using the iron, as we start to release that back into the plant, that boron level may come up on its own.
Gotcha.
So that's pretty much what you've got going on there. Again, nothing really that needs major corrective. The K level in the backyard, that's something I would look at to really bump that up over the course of a year. You know, getting a major correction on potassium is typically a 2 to 3 year process, because if you put too much out at a time, you can really dry out the plant.
Yeah.
And that you don't really want to do that.
Gotcha.
That's all I'm seeing here.
Okay.
Not really much else. I mean, if you start off with the balance of the pH, get a good feeding coming into springtime, that's going to help just to buffer everything out throughout the season, and we can start to fill in some of these other elements with pretty much everything we have on the rack right now.
Gotcha. So what would be your advice to homeowners when they get these soil analysis back and they're trying to figure it out and paint a roadmap? I mean, because like I said, when I look at it, I'm like, this is Spanish.
So the big thing to take a look at is this. If you get a soil test and you get a recommendation of what should be applied, like on this one, if you go down to the bottom of the page, you can see there's recommendations for nutrients. Just kind of going across the majors. There's a standard application of N. If you choose to follow that, that's up to you. Obviously, I don't. I don't look at that. I don't think it's important.
Right.
But moving across, so into phosphorus, to correct your deficiencies, it's 1.1 pounds per thousand. Now, that's not even, I shouldn't even say that, because on here, this is your backyard, that's just sort of a baseline recommendation on removal, and you're not going to be removing any clippings, so there's no reason to even look at that corrective one, again, moving across the board. Moving into the potassium, where it says 3.8 pounds recommended, that is corrective. Again, you cannot do that in the course of a year. Don't even try. That is something that takes a while to build up. So when you have a major deficiency, you're not looking at a single season to change this over. This is going to take 2 seasons, 3 seasons, 4 seasons to really build up the difference. And you don't really need to soil test every year.
Yeah, and I think that's something that Mike said is, you know, every 3 to 5 years is when you want to start taking a look at it. And it makes sense now that, you know, you have to build all this stuff up, like you were saying, over the course of 3 to 4 seasons, which is why to check back in after 5 to see where you're at.
Yeah, it makes more sense to take the slow roll on this one and just to work down the list. Start with pH, working on that. Organic matter, working on that. We know that if we want to ultimately balance pH for the good, we need to have more organic matter in the soil. If we want to have a better cationic exchange capacity where we're getting more surfaces in there, we need more organic matter, we need more humus. That's going to come from plant growth more than anything else. So focusing on getting limiting factors removed, balanced out, so that we know we can drive roots down and push, we're gonna be able to balance a significant amount of everything else on this list without a whole lot of work.
Gotcha. Well, that makes sense. Like, focusing on the one will start to balance out the others as a side effect. Is that right?
That's right.
Gotcha. Okay. Cool. I can't think of anything. Any other 2 cents you wanna throw in there?
No, I don't think so. I think that people need to just relax about their soil test. There's no such thing as a bad soil test.
Yeah.
Just a map. Everything is just a map. So never think about, oh, this is bad. No.
Yeah.
Think about it like, now you know where to start.
Gotcha.
So that's what I would advise to everybody out there. Don't freak out.
This is just a roadmap to get you where you need to go.
That's exactly right. And in many cases, it took, however many hundreds of millions of years to create this particular soil that you're dealing with, especially if it's from a fresh ground in the back. And don't expect to change it in 2 applications.
Right. Gotcha. Cool. I think that's it.
Great.
Awesome. Well, I appreciate it. Keep on doing what it is you do.
I'll do that. I will make sure I continue to do that.
Awesome. We'll appreciate it, and we'll chat with you later.
Sounds good, buddy. Talk to you soon. See ya.
There you go. And there you go. That's my soil analysis. High five to John Perry for helping me decipher that. So the biggest takeaway I got from this, it's not gonna happen in one season. The issues that you have going on, the low pH, the high pH, whatever the case may be, it's different for every yard. You're not gonna fix that in just one season. It's gonna take multiple seasons. And again, like I said earlier in the video, it makes sense why Mike Hall suggests that you do a soil analysis every 3 to 5 years, because it is gonna take that much time to get the turf balanced out and get the soil to where it needs to be. I hope that was helpful and you have kind of a better idea of how to read a soil analysis. If you have any other questions, drop those in the comments below. Thumbs up if you like the video, share it, all that good social media stuff. Keep on keeping on, my lawn care brothers and sisters from other misters, and I will catch you next time. I mean, you gotta see the humor in this. Schools all across the city have shut down because of the threat of a wintry mix. I mean, no words.